Beer that's a little less heavy, never bitter, but with all the spirit you look for in a beer, Coors is the one.
In the shadow of the skyscrapers of Dayton, Ohio, is the Dayton, Ohio Hydro Bowl, the home of the 1985 Inboard Speedboat Championship. Hello, everyone. I'm Ken Squire. As we get set for the finals, over 200 entries came here, and through days of elimination, we're down two of the very best finalists. It's been as hectic, as wild, and exciting qualifying period as they've ever had here. Working with us today are Bob Barsham and the six-time national champion, Jim Kropfeld.
Thank you, Ken. Yes, these have been the most exciting championships in years. We've seen the great kind of competitive action, but we've also seen problematic sort of action. Six drivers thus far in these championships have made trips to the hospitals following incredible accidents. I imagine we're probably going to see some more of that kind of action as these finals go on. Jim?
Well, the reason for these accidents, I think, is that we have over 200 entrants here, and the boats are all very competitive, the same speed, basically, and the drivers are very intense. They're driving very hard.
Here's what we're talking about. Friday afternoon, six leader eliminations. Einar Glacius of Detroit on the right, Chuck Woodruff of Miami, Florida on the left. After the checkered flag, suddenly the Glacius boat goes out of control, and this terrifying accident results. Jim, is there any way we can know what might have caused this kind of crash as we look at it once again on a replay?
Well, we can see here Einar's boat coming down on the right. It takes three or four hard bounces on his sponson. The last bounce on his right sponson causes the boat to veer to the right, directly in front of Chuck Woodruff and the Buckeye Kid. Chuck, seeing this, tries to turn to the right. Not enough room, spins around, crashes into Einar's boat, thrown from the boat, and his helmet is thrown off from the tremendous crash. The boat spins around, barely missing Chuck as it goes past him. Chuck bouncing across the water at about 120 mile an hour.
These pictures were taken by a spectator in the large crowd gathered here at Dayton for the national championships. We're pleased to report that both Einar Glacius and Chuck Woodruff, despite the terrifying nature of this accident, are reportedly recovering nicely in Dayton area hospitals.
Thank you, Bob. We'll be back for the United States 6-liter inboard finals after these messages.
When the big Q flows.
You await the 6-liter finale. Let's go to the Mercury Racing headquarters with Jerry Garrett and racer Sandy Ray, who we'll see in the 145 finals later.
Well, down at this end of the course is the pits, and this is where the boats are winched in and out of the water with cranes. This is where they're gassed up and where they're inspected. Out on the course, Sandy, what are you going to be watching for today?
I'm going to be watching for the wind. It seems to be blowing pretty good out there.
And in your race, you're watching for a particular competitor, too.
Yes, I am. I'm watching for Wheeler Wilson, who they call the Wizard. He's running really well.
He's got a whole house full of trophies. You're just starting out, but you don't feel intimidated.
No, I know my boat's running well, and I know I'm going to do the best I can do, and if what I end up with, I'll just be satisfied.
Well, that's just one of the stories we'll be watching today.
Jerry, how about giving us a description of these Group 6 boats and the kind of people involved in racing them?
These moderate-sized boats are capable of better than 150-mile-an-hour speeds, although the class record of 152 has stood for 14 years. The most popular engines come from Ford and Chevy passenger cars. 1983 national champ Jerry Scheidt is one of the strong contenders in this class, as is veteran Ray Miller, who says these boats are a real handful to control.
The real challenge is when you get to the corner and have to turn it. We have two long straightaways here and two fairly tight turns, so the boats are reaching really top speed by the end of the straightaway, and then you have to start turning, and that's the problem.
U.S. Inboard Championships are decided in two three-lap races. There's points for each. Describe the point system and the first race in Group 6. Here's Bob Barsham.
Thank you, Ken. As you mentioned, these are two heat finals with points awarded for place within each heat. As you can see, there are 400 points to be had for first place, 300 for second, with odd numbers of points awarded thereafter in order to avoid ties. Highest cumulative score after two heats determines the champion. Now for those highlights from Heat 1. This was the start of Heat 1 in the Mercruiser Formula 6-liter division of the APBA National Championships. Taking the early lead was 1983 national champion Jerry Scheidt, a hometown boy out of Dayton, Ohio, driving boat number 78, the Bud Light boat. But he battled as he danced down the backstretch at speeds approaching 150 miles an hour with this man, 33-year-old Jim Browning out of Virginia Beach, Virginia, driving boat number 9, Pachanga. At least a half dozen times, Browning and Scheidt exchanged the lead in this three-lap heat before Browning finally put Pechanga's nose out front to stay. It wasn't easy as Browning looked back, coming off the final turn. There was Jerry Scheidt and Bud Light shadowing him all the way to the finish line. Nevertheless, Jim Browning of Virginia Beach, Virginia, was able to keep Pechanga out front and win the first of two final heats in the Mercruiser Formula 6-liter division. But Jim Browning's day was to end abruptly on this, the start of the second heat. Ray Miller put Deuces Wild up front with Browning moving up on the outside as they made their way up the long backstretch before this. Browning thrown from his spinning machine, retrieved from the water and taken to the hospital unconscious. Jim Kropfeld, let's take a look at the replay.
Jim's left sponson digs once, twice, spinning, throwing him violently from the cockpit. Jimmy, who is not strapped in, is thrown into the water at over 150 mile an hour.
Ironically, driving the same boat his brother Terry crashed at the Eastern Divisional Championship, severely breaking his right leg, Jim Browning has now crashed. We'll have an update on his condition later on in the program.
Awaiting a restart on the second and final three-lap heat for the 6-liter boats after Jim Browning hospitalized in that terrible crash. Now leading in points will be Jerry Scheidt, the Bud Light boat, local boat from Dayton, Ohio. Deuces Wild, Ray Miller out of Winter Haven, Florida. He's qualified for this final. Summer Dreams, the Canadian Alex Stewart. Foxy Lady, Ed Laughing Wolf from Michigan. Bounty Hunter, Robert Newton of Dayton, Ohio. Line Cripple and Crazy, Richard McPherson, another Canadian campaigner. Turner On, John Turner's boat from Grand Island, New York. And Magnificent Obsession, Joe Williams, another Ohio campaigner, all making this final round of Group 6, and we prepare for the start. Let's go to Turn 4, the Mercury Racing Headquarters, standing by Jerry Garrett and Sandy Ray.
Well, Sandy, the equation's pretty simple in this race. You have to win the championship.
Yeah, we have Bud Light on the inside and Deuces Wild right next to him.
Okay, down to you, Ken, for the start.
4 seconds away from the line. Bud Light, national champion in E3, Jerry Scheidt on the inside, gets the break. Clean start.
Bud Light on the inside. Ray Miller and Deuces Wild, lane two, and Summer Dreams in lane three, going into turn one, and Bud Light is out in front.
But now moving up quickly is Deuces Wild. Deuces Wild taking a shot at first place as they round turn number two. Let's see who comes out on top. Deuces Wild is there, 53-year-old Ray Miller for the moment.
Ken, Ray has been racing 18 years, and if he wins this heat, it will be his first national championship.
That's Ray Miller, 1985 U.S. Eastern champion, going for the national title here today.
Back straight away, Deuces Wild, 368 cubic inch machines grinding it out here in this finale. Winner take all.
Well, Bud Light's got some problems down here at the West End. Kenny seems to be out of the throttle. He's got all the way back to fourth place now.
And leading as they complete lap number one is Ray Miller. Earlier, we saw Jim Browning with a terrible crash at turn number three. How much of that is just bad luck? How much of that is trial and error, Jim?
I believe it was all bad luck. The competition was so intense that they couldn't even think about backing off.
Well, now we're watching Ray Miller out of Winter Haven, Florida.
Ken, there's Jerry Scheidt back in the pits. He has the best chance to win this whole championship.
Bad break for Jerry Scheidt. Looks like the motor's gone away. Here's the man out in front. It's Deuces Wild, Ray Miller first. And there you see the Canadian boat of Alex Stewart, Summer Dream in second place. And there's the third place boat, the Bounty Hunter, a Dayton, Ohio campaigner, Robert Newman. And here coming around in fourth place is Foxy Lady, Ed Laughingwell. 1,300-pound boat skimming over the Dayton Hydro Bowl. And here's the man everyone's talking about.
Ray Miller holds on. These boats capable of nearly 150 miles per hour the straightaway, 112 mile an hour average on a mile and two-thirds course.
Fast boat, it's fast speed. Ray's coming down on the green flag lap.
Second place boat. Here comes Summer Dream, Alex Stewart out of Canada.
We mentioned the wind that contributed to Jim Browning's crash not long ago, Jim. How does the wind look and the water look to you now?
It's beautiful now. The wind has dropped off almost completely. Ray's boat is set up to perfection right now. He's having a beautiful ride going to the turn first.
Ray Miller, father of six children, over 50 years of age, trying to take this national championship.
I'd have to say this is a ride of his life. He's never won a national championship before.
Here they are coming around. Checkered flag is about to come out.
Alex,
here they are, down
in
the back straightaway, last time.
Very steady through this final turn. He's got the boat hooked up just like he wants. Very conservative pace, heading right down to that checkered flag. He can just about see it now.
He's got an exhaust header loose on that boat.
The exhaust header is loose. It's flopping. I hope that he hangs on till he finishes. Coming down. You can see it shaking right there.
The national champion, Ray Miller, Deuces Wild Boat from Winter Haven, Florida, wins Group 6.
We'll be back at Dayton, Ohio for one of the best classes of all. You're going to enjoy the Jersey Racing Skiffs right after these messages.
Welcome to these, the Inboard National Championships of the world's oldest powerboat racing association. You are seeing our best drivers and finest equipment. But all over the country, all over the world, there are thousands of other members. They're involved in a full range of boating activities, from family class outboard racing where you can participate for $1,000 to the professional inboards where the investment can run over $100,000. It's a great sport and a great group. If you're interested, please write or call us. We'd love to hear from you.
Hello. Standings in Group 6. Bob Barsha is standing by with the new U.S. champion from Winter Haven, Florida, Ray Miller.
Ray, it looked to be a showdown there for a while, but you wound up having a cakewalk. How did it feel to win that national championship?
Just fantastic. We did it the hard way, just like we did in Raleigh about 6 weeks ago for the Eastern championship. We had a third down there in the first heat and came back with a first in the second heat, and that's what we did here today.
Jerry Scheidt was going to put some pressure on you toward the end there. He had a mechanical problem. Were you aware that he was out of the race?
No, I thought he was right behind me the whole time. We don't have rear-view mirrors, so I wasn't taking any chances.
It appeared to us like the exhaust header came loose on the right side there in the late stages. Was that a concern for you?
Mine?
Yeah.
I wasn't aware of that.
So I guess it wasn't much of a concern.
It sounded a little strange when I came in. I may have to get towed back to the pits.
Well, it lasted long enough. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob. Maritime Madness is next. They call it the Jersey Skiffs. Jerry Garrett, how about a description of these boats?
These bouncing bundles of energy are powered by small block V8s like the 283 Chevy. Besides a lot of horsepower, these boats pack something unique. A co-driver or riding mechanic. There's not much for him or her to do. Just relax and enjoy the wild ride as best you can. Keep an eye on boat number JS32, Bob Birdsall, in this one, as well as the man who holds all the records in this class, Rob Garantano in JS11.
It may look like fun and games, but it can get just a bit hairy out here. In the first three-lap finale, Jack Stetzer was about to evict his passenger without any notice. He lost control, and more importantly, lost his passenger, Patty Grabowski, rescued from the briny deep, uninjured, very unsure if she wanted to continue her career as navigator.
In the upper left-hand corner of your screen, you see our one-minute clock, tolling the seconds from the one-minute gun to zero, the start of the race. The start is purely a matter of anticipation. Each skipper has a stopwatch in his boat, tolling the seconds down to zero. The idea is to choose the best position, the inside position, the shortest route, and be at top speed when you reach the finish line at zero. Ken?
And so now we are ready for the three laps to decide the Jersey Skiffs National Championship 1985, which looks for these eight teams about as much fun as a night and a day in a washer-dryer. Here they are. They'll be able to attain some 80 miles per hour. That's the boat to watch, JS11 Indian Summer, boat out of New Jersey. They used to know those New Jersey shores well. Clean start, and we're away. Out in front quickly goes Together Again, Robert Bromwell of Cambridge, Maryland. But here comes the yellow and orange boat, Indian Summer, Eastern Division champion. That's Robert Garantano of Oceanport, New Jersey, with his cohort, Kevin McMullen, riding.
You notice, Ken, these are the only boats that require two passengers, if you will. Actually, the driver is doing all the work. Riding mechanic is what they call a fella who rides alongside, although as we've seen, it's not always a fella. But Jim Kropfeld, there isn't a whole lot for that mechanic to do during this race.
The best thing he can do is just hang on for all he's worth.
In the old days, that was the shotgun position. These boats are a throwback to the days of Prohibition, when these boats became best known for far more nefarious activities than racing.
That's right. They developed from what we call the rum runner. Anyone familiar with Prohibition can remember when the illegal spirits were brought over from the European countries and the mother ship sat outside the 3-mile limit. And these boats right here with the hatch hole in the top, as you can see, were sent out to bring in the illegal booze.
Spirits. Spirits are running high right now for JS-11 Indian Summer. Robert Garantano in a very serious business of trying to win this national championship with these cumbersome, difficult boats.
Robert's a great driver. They have this boat set up very well, Ken. Everything is running to perfection.
There you see Robert Garantano, Kevin McMullen in the front running position. Meanwhile, looking further back in the field, it's the Bromwell boat running in the second position now. Robert Bromwell of Cambridge, Maryland, together again. And right alongside is Bob Bertzels for the Birds. He's from West Palm Beach, Florida. They're running side by side for second place.
It's a good race for second place. Number one, the S1 boat, is holding on to the inside lane. He has the advantage right there, Ken.
Here he is coming up in second position together again. Robert Bromwell out of Cambridge, Maryland. And for the Birds, Bob Bertzel sails back into third place. What makes a good team a good boat in this competition?
Well, it's the boats, the hulls, the engines, the propellers. Everything is very much similar. All the specifications are the same on these boats. And the only difference is maybe propeller selection and driving ability.
You see them bouncing like corks. Do they ever get them upside down?
Well, very seldom do they turn upside down, although you'll notice they will get up on their side quite a bit in the turns.
Here they are, back in the main straightaway. Top speed, a little over 80 miles per hour. Robert Garantano has won the national championship before, and there's the number one boat together again. Robert Bromwell of Cambridge, Maryland, hanging tough in here in this three-lap championship round, again with the leaders.
Can you see these boats, how they bounce? And our viewers may wonder, why don't they run smooth like the other boats? On the bottom of these boats, they have a little step that is designed to make them bounce, so it simulates ocean racing.
Down into the final moments, Bromwell's boat in second, and now for the Birds, Bob Bertzel's boat, the Florida boat, has fallen to third place. Getting ready to decide this one, and it will all be in favor of the New Jersey team out of Oceanport, where originally those boats did a little running back in the late 20s and early 30s.
That's right. Of course, it wasn't the same boats we're seeing here. These boats are all fiberglass construction, as the old days they were naturally made out of wood.
All right, here he comes. Robert Garantano from Oceanport, New Jersey, coming around the final buoy and headed for the national championship, unless something gets untethered here. Carries a small load in the bottom and it gets loose or something. There you see the second and third place boats coming around. As we get down to the finish, the Bromwell boat in second, the Bertzel boat in third. But give it all today to Kevin McMullen, holding on for dear life, bouncing like a cork here across the Hydroplane in Dayton, Ohio. A big advantage being enjoyed by his pilot, Robert Garantano, as he brings it on home. A payload for Garantano winning the championship with JS-11 rounding that final buoy and headed for home.
He's coming down the home stretch. He has a very substantial lead. You notice the second place boat is just coming into the turn as the JS-11 Indian Summer is coming out of it. Turn down the home stretch.
McMullen, looking over at the crowd, must have seen something he liked there. Here he is coming up for the line. JS-11 for another time is going to win the United States Championship. McMullen and Robert Garantano from New Jersey. Oh, don't shake hands until you're down to the last bounce, gentlemen. Robert Bromwell is going to come across in second place. The boat together again. There they are, together again. Number one in second place, and bobbing home third, the boat for the Birds, Bob Bertzel from down in Florida. More in a moment.
And I'll meet the masters of the Jersey skiffs, Garantano and McMullen.
We're here with the 1985 APBA Jersey Skiff Champions, Robert Garantano and riding mechanic Keith McMullen. Bob, now you've got another national championship to go with all those records. How was the ride?
It was pretty good. It was a little rough on the back straightaway, but all things considered, it was a very good race.
You guys absolutely dominated both heats. Now, these are ostensibly identical boats. What gave you that kind of advantage?
A lot of backyard homework, a lot of research, and just a lot of time and effort that goes into just making everything right there.
Keith, your role as a riding mechanic, obviously there's nothing to fix out there. Are you basically just along for the ride?
I'm another set of eyes, and I watch the gauges and just kind of help him out best I can.
How'd the ride go from your perspective?
It was great. I love it.
Congratulations to both of you on a national championship.
Thank you very much.
Back to you, Ken.
Thanks, Bob Varsha. One of the most popular and competitive divisions in the American Powerboat Association is the 145 class, 145 cubic inches. All Pinto engines out here. And with more on them, here's Jerry Garrett.
This is a class that's been around a long time. They're relatively inexpensive and reliable boats to run. They are also easy to maneuver and fun to race. It's a good class to start with and stay with. Two cases in point, the top two contenders. 19-year-old Sandy Ray, our co-commentator, does well in this class, as does grandfather Willard Wilson, a fixture in 145s for almost 30 years.
But I don't notice a great difference between now and 28 years ago, frankly, as far as racing is concerned. It's more a technique type of thing than a physical. You can run a mile and probably do a lot more work than you can physical work. It takes a little mental discipline.
Here in the highlights of the first heat of these 145 cubic inch finals, you get an idea of what Willard Wilson is talking about. From the outside lane, running left to right across your picture, Willard Wilson takes the early lead in this first heat. In the yellow boat to the right, Sandra Ray had the inside line, but so anxious was she to beat Willard the Wizard Wilson that she jumped the start and was disqualified. At that point, it was a walkover for the grandfather from Wilmington, Delaware, and Willard Wilson zoomed away to gather all 400 points for victory in the first heat. But Sandy will have another shot at Willard in the next final.
So the stage is set for the 145 class finale. Beauty trying to come before age as 18-year-old Sandy Ray, Western U.S. champ, meets 57-year-old Willard Wilson, the Eastern U.S. champ. Let's go to Jerry Garrett at the Mercury Marine Racing Headquarters in Turn 4.
Okay, it's taken three tries, but 19-year-old Sandy Ray's finally got the position she wants. She's in the inside lane. Difference in styles, 57-year-old Willard Wilson way on the outside. Down to you, Ken, for the start.
Sandy Ray trying to break away. Wilson taking the outside line, which he likes so much. Almost up against the beach. They hit the clock, and they are underway.
And we have Sandy Ray. She's in lane two, but she is out in front. Willard Wilson about in lane eight, and Andiamo going down the outside along the beach.
Here they are around that first and second turn area for the first time.
It's Sam DeRay out in front in Country Girl, and on the outside it looks like Willard Wilson coming around in Little Electron.
The high line, he hits the apex right where he wanted to. Five buoys out there, and he took the center one and nailed it.
Sanders coming up the backstretch, but on the outside we see Willard Wilson. There's Sanders' boat riding beautiful.
19-year-old Sandra Ray from Azusa, California.
She's looking around. She can hear Mr. Wilson and Little Electron coming right up behind her.
The grandfather, Willard Wilson, closing ground now, closing up.
Sandra must be very proud to drive next to Willard. And there he goes around, Sandra, entering turn three, taking the wide lane. Sandy is holding her pins, coming around.
The Wilmington, Delaware campaigner goes out in front. Five-time national champion, Willard Wilson in front, coming by, clean start. Lap down as they come to the line. It is a struggle for first. There they are, side by side, and for the moment, Wilson has it by three boat lengths.
A lot of air under Willard's boat there. You saw it kiting as it came across. And in third position, Tom Deeth.
Now you know Tom Deeth very well.
I don't imagine, Jim. I sure do. Tom Deeth, I campaigned against him last week in Seattle.
There's your leader, Willard Wilson, in front, but having to fight for it every inch of the way. Second place continues to be Sandra Ray.
There's Sandy on the inside. She has the best track around, best circuit, shortest circuit.
So they are driving two different types of hulls. There's Wilson's.
That's Willard Wilson. He has a Ron Jones hull built in Seattle, Washington. Sandra has a Belleville hull built in Southern California.
He looks back so blithely as though he's covering up what city block a second. He's looking back for his competition.
He's traveling around a football field and a half, about 500 foot a minute there, or a second, I'm sorry.
We see him lean to the inside. We've seen drivers actually reach out and grab the left sponson in the smaller hydros in order to keep their balance coming through those turns.
One lap to go, this time by Little Electron, Mr. 145, current Eastern champion, going for the U.S. title here today, Willard Wilson. There's Sandra Ray in second place.
Sandy's driven a beautiful race. She was disqualified the first heat for jumping the gun, and it's a shame. She could at least have a second place if she would have not done that.
Around the first and second turn, Willard Wilson trying to stretch his national titles to six. It looked like he had almost too tight that time.
Almost too tight. I think he was ready to spin. There's a couple wakes, and he probably had a bad wake in that area. Cut to the inside. Now you see Sandra on the outside. Willard has a substantial lead now. I think he realizes that he's almost the national champion for 1985.
Sandra Ray told me before this race, if she finishes in second, that'll be her best performance ever in nationals competition.
Down to it. Final turn, final time for the national championship. Willard Wilson, an experience that he has felt before. Sandra Ray wanted so much to take it away from him, but she'll have to wait another year. Looking back is Willard Wilson.
And he's looking back to see where Sandra is. He's probably going to slow down a little bit to be sure nothing goes wrong. He doesn't want to take a chance of something happening to his engine.
The world speed record holder for the 145 class comes across waving. Willard Wilson is the winner, picks up another 400 points. Pinto engine, 2,000 cc's, as the flagman puts the checkers down for Wilson to win the national championship. Thank goodness that could have been his grandson. Bob Barsha will meet the racing grandfather from Delaware who has won the national title in the 145 class here in Dayton, Ohio.
The 1984 145 class champion, Willard Wilson of Wilmington, Delaware, has successfully defended his crown here in Dayton, Ohio. He's with Bob Barsha right now.
All right, five-time, now six-time national champion Willard Wilson, the Wizard, they call him. Do they get any sweeter with age, Willard?
No, they still feel just as good almost. Really just as good. But the first one was the greatest one.
You dominated both heats. How did the boat run?
Well, I broke a prop in the first heat, broke a tip-off. And I had to run a prop that wasn't quite as good, and I had to work a lot harder that second heat.
Sandy Ray was running behind you at 17 years old. Did you feel any competition from the young lady?
Oh, sure. Oh, yeah. She's a terrific driver.
Will you ever give it up?
If my health requires that I give it up, I would.
Well, congratulations. Great race. Willard Wilson, the national champion.
Jerry Garrett standing by with a runner-up and our co-anchor at the Mercury Racing headquarters here today, Sandy Ray.
The two things that mattered, I guess, to you in this is, number one, the national championship. You couldn't win that because Willard won both ends of it anyway. The second thing was being able to race competitively with Willard.
Yeah, that's true. I feel I did exceptionally well, and Willard has a very fast boat, and just running second to Willard is good enough for me.
Now the big boys are getting ready to play. Jerry Garrett, how about a description of the Group 7 boats as they get ready for their finale?
Big boys is right, Ken. These monster boats are over 20 feet long, powered by big block V8s, and they just fly along the water. Driving one of these is about like wrestling an alligator. You need forearms like Popeye and nerves of steel. Veteran Stover Heyer would normally be a strong contender, but Heyer and everyone else has learned to fear and respect John Prevost's radical superboat, Shazam, the new 7-liter world record holder.
The 7-liter boats at these APBA Inboard Nationals in Dayton, Ohio are among the most high-tech, the fastest, the most dangerous, and the most expensive of all. Here in the highlights of the first of two point-scoring heats in the 7-liter finals, we witness the most menacing and, in fact, the most high-tech of the 7-liters, the black number J200 Shazam, driven by John Prevost of Baton Rouge, Louisiana. His only competition, the yellow J37 boat, Project 7, the Eastern Division champion, driven by Glenn Coatney of Fort Myers, Florida. But despite a great drive by Coatney, one got the impression that the Project 7 boat was totally overmatched by the computer technology of Shazam, designed by Ed Carlson, also out of Louisiana, taking the turns much flatter than the rest of the boats. In fact, sounding different than the rest of the boats, John Prevost out of Baton Rouge walked away to an easy victory in the first heat of the 7-liter division, not without some damage to the right front sponson of that boat that's going to have to be repaired before the second heat of these finals.
Group 7 drivers have been hard hit by injuries. Jerry Garrett, who are we missing here?
Well, Ken, two of the favorites in this class won't be racing because they are injured while racing in other classes. That's the J2 Project 7, Glenn Coatney. He'll be replaced by D. Wisely, a 2.5-liter driver. He's from Seminole, Florida. And in J77, the Southern 7, Glenn Coatney and Charles Woodruff, either one of those drivers were slated to drive. Both of those got injured. Tim Baker is going to be the driver in that one now.
Let's review the finalists for Group 7. Shazam, driven by John Prevost out of Louisiana. Hot Stuff, Stover Hire, the Syracuse, Indiana campaign. Then there's Project 7, D. Wisely, Florida driver. And the J77, the Southern 7 boat, you see it right there. That is Tim Baker. Four boats, three laps. The clock counting down the time to the start. If they cross the line before that clock has run out, they're disqualified. There you see Shazam. Let's go to Jerry Garrett at turn four.
Well, for the national championship, we've got a wounded boat versus a wounded driver, Sandy.
Well, this heat looks pretty good. Shazam's our last heat winner, and he's right where he wants to be.
He's got his boat repaired, hopefully, and it'll stand up for the final all the way.
Hopefully.
The wounded boat, the black machine, Shazam, of John Prevost, the wounded driver, Stover Meyer, who flipped over backwards yesterday in his 5-liter boat. The yellow boat right there as we get off to a start, Hot Stuff.
That's right, into the first turn, side by side. Stover on the outside, John Prevost on the inside. He's taking the advantage.
John Prevost has the record at 148 miles per hour with his boat, Shazam. As they go into the back straight away, he tries to become Captain Marvel as on the outside, the yellow boat. Hot Stuff, Stover Hire. The electrician comes after it. Meanwhile, pulling in the third is Ted Baker, taking over for Charles Woodruff, who was also injured in Friday's racing.
We have a lot of injuries in this class over the weekend, and we have three alternate drivers running this weekend.
Kind of ironic that we've got a broken boat in first place and broken drivers in second and third.
Here's the lead machine, once again, going for it. John Prevost, 47 years old, from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Shazam out in front, but not by much. Still gaining a little ground back here. Is that yellow boat, Hot Stuff?
I would imagine Stover's having problems staying in his seat. His left knee has been injured, as we said, and that's a leg that you use to push yourself back into the seat to hold yourself in the boat.
Again, these are 7-liter boats.
That's right, 7 liters, 450 cubic inches, 4-valve carburetor, about 600 horsepower.
And it was a boat from this division that moved up into the blown 7-liter class and managed to beat the more exotic craft in yesterday's heat racing.
There you see them once again taking the high line. Off the corner is the yellow boat, Stover Hire, still trying to close ground.
I have to assume Stover's boat doesn't turn too well tight on the pins because he's going very wide, and normally you want to run in a little closer.
Meanwhile, John Prevost pinches it right on the pin as he goes down here once again. Laps running out, national championship at stake.
Ken, as he's coming down to start this final heat, I'm sure John's worried about his engine, and you know he has an onboard computer where he can monitor all of his engine functions.
Two-time national champion, trying for a third, John Prevost. He's a car dealer, foreign car dealer, down in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, but right now he is flying toward a championship, perhaps. And still, Stover Hire won't let go of that yellow machine.
Stover won't back off. He's a real charger. He's been a charger ever since I've known him. For about 25 years, he's been driving all classes of boats.
Class 7, ultimate speed in these hydroplanes, inboard, U.S. Championship, Dayton, Ohio. Here they come, and on the outside, you see that Southern 7 boat running third, way on the top of your screen.
Way on the outside. Teddy's running a wide course. This is the first time he's been in this boat, and I'm sure he's being very, very careful.
Young racer out of Queenstown, Maryland, replacing Charles Woodruff, who was injured 2 days ago. All right, top, here comes Shazam once again. John Prevost. That boat looks so solid when it goes through the corners.
It does. That's because it's a new design, as we said, by Ed Carlson, and it's a very safe hold.
Here he is coming up to the line. Last time through. And the Formula 7 championship belongs to Louisiana's John Prevost. Finishing in second is Stover Hire. And crossing third is Ted Baker, taking over in the Southern 7 for this finale. There's the second place boat, Stover Hire. And the third place boat, Southern 7. Ted Baker, Queenstown, Maryland. And you'll meet the champion, John Prevost, after these words.
The worst stock market crash in history.
Here at Dayton, Ohio, John Prevost has carried the day in Group 7. He's standing by with Bob Varsha and his boat builder, Ed Carrollson.
John Prevost, there were fights with officials, there were fights with delays, there were fights with a broken boat. That national crown has to feel pretty good.
Well, it really does. This is something that a lot of people have worked hard for, not just myself. We've had, at a time like this, you really need to thank a lot of people. And Ed Carrollson built a fabulous boat, and Glenn Cupid and Artie Ross and David Artigo has helped me with it. And they work endlessly, hours after hour, and it's just been a fabulous, fabulous experience. That boat is really a neat boat, and we've been lucky.
We've been real lucky.
You had a problem with the boat. You had to do some rapid repairs before the second heat of the final, but it didn't look like you were letting up on it at all out there. How was the drive?
Oh, it was fine. The first time I went into the corner, I was really concerned that it might let go, but everything, our crew is just the best, and so they held it together, and it was just perfect.
Ed, let me ask you real quick. How did the repair come about? Was there any problem getting the boat ready for the final?
Oh, no. This is a thing that happens when it does break. That's one place it does break, just from the sharp turns and the water pressure. So we knew what it looked like before we even, got into it much.
Jim Kropfeld spoke at length about your boat and how it's got a new design. Do you see this as the next step in unlimited racing? Unlimited in the hydroplane, that is?
Well, it all depends on what the owners want. This is a much safer design. That's the reason I talked John into it. We've been friends for years, and he wants to race, and I want to keep him safe while he's racing.
Well, congratulations to you both. A hard-earned championship. Take it back to Louisiana.
Thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
Well, Bob, the traditional parade lap's already begun for the K-Racing runabouts. These boats are the real run-what-you-brung class here at Dayton. There's no minimum or maximum boat length, no restrictions at all on engine size or fuel. Basically, if it'll float and move, you can race it. The favorite here figures to be George Woods in the Outlaw, a boat that's aptly named for this class. Another guy in the race whose boat is aptly named is Harry Christensen in the Long Shot.
Let's review earlier action from these monsters, the K-boats.
This was the scene as they came to the line in the grand finale of this APBA boat racing weekend. The K-boats, the Crazy K's, the Run What You Brung class. On the outside in the brown boat, George Woods Jr. out of Sumner, Washington, trying to get the lead going into turn one, but it's the black boat of Roger Glover out of Reno, Nevada, who takes the early lead. Out of the turn, onto the two-thirds of a mile backstretch here at the Dayton Hydro Bowl. It's Woods on the outside in the brown boat, and then just as quickly, he lost the lead to Jay Ellington in the blue boat. On the inside, it's Roger Glover once again out of Reno, Nevada, reaching a terminal velocity somewhere in excess of 140 miles an hour. Blown, fuel-injected, methanol-powered boats. Jim Kropfeld, I guess it's just a matter of who has the most courage to keep going through the turns in these things.
That's right, Bob. It's a matter of, as you notice, they slow down into turns, get through as best they can, but then they put that 1,000-plus horsepower, nail it, mass acceleration.
Watch the boat on the right of your screen for an example of what can happen, as Roger Glover nearly had his boat taken out from under him in this very first heat of the K-Racing runabout class. Back down the front straightaway, speeds of 140 miles an hour. The blue boat in the center of your picture is Jay Ellington. The brown boat on the outside is George Woods Jr. in Outlaw. Back into turn one, very narrow turns on this Dayton Hydro Bowl course, making these K-Racing machines even more difficult to handle. Through turn one, into turn two, Jay Ellington in the blue boat in the lead. George Woods Jr. in the brown boat to the outside. The race is to see who can get the hammer down first. Jay Ellington wins the race. He pulls out to a lead, and Jay Ellington went on to win the first heat in the K-Racing runabout division.
There you see the finalists in K-Racing, highlighted by, trust me, the Eastern Division champion, George Nordling from Milwaukee, Oregon. Longshot, Harry Christensen of Anaheim, California. The Outlaw, George Woods Jr. out of Sumner, Washington. E.T., that's Jay Ellington from Orange, California, getting set for a start here.
Well, Sandy, the wind seems to have come up here as they come down for the start of this race. Is it going to be a problem?
No, with the flat bottoms, they seem to run good in the wind. This shouldn't affect them at all.
Okay, Ken, let's have the start.
Here they come, the super modifieds, the top fuel dragsters, the K-Racers. Harry Christian trying for the lead. Here they come to the first turn.
He's in lane one. He's going into turn first.
Seven boats all looking for the line. And as they go into that first turn, fighting their way number two, Sumner Washington's. George Wood is going out in front. Wood is going into the first position. Ellington running second, Nordley in third, the back straightaway. There you see Wood holding on for dear life, and now a new second place. George Nordley passes Ellington. That's Nordley now in second position.
That's bad news for first heat winner Ellington, Ken. He has got to get back into second place as long as Wood stays up front.
George Wood holding on for dear life, out in front, the Sumner Washington campaigner. Boy, look at that machine track.
It turns beautiful, Ken. He has it set up very nicely, but it's a rough ride.
A revenge boat, the Imperial Palace entry out of Nevada for George Wood. He's 35 years old, married, started racing on outboards when he was 17, and he's driven just about everything there is to run.
He's been around in all the classes, hydroplanes, flat bottoms, you name it, he's done it.
On a golden sea here at the end of the day in Dayton, Ohio, the big boats are out. Here they are, thundering once again at top speed. These boats started life as drag boats. Most lethal form of boat racing there is. Then they were called hot boats when they first started making ovals. Now they're in the K class, and you're seeing one of the very best, George Wood, fighting off Nordley. Nordley is making a challenge in the gray boat on the outside.
And notice the rough ride he's having. He's swirling, as we call it, left and right up the rough water on the backstretch.
Nordley making a real effort to overtake the leader, George Wood.
This is the man. Place on the course up in that turn three where we had a couple accidents so far.
Browning, that terrible crash we saw earlier. Here he is, Nordley pulling up, trying to challenge. He's up on the outside, but still staying in front is Washington's George Wood. Sells trucks day to day, but on weekends just likes to go out and do a little boating.
And Ken, here comes that big drag race down into the start of the third lap.
Third and final lap. There you see him, Woods there, Nordley trying to close again. Both of these guys put out a sign that says "Have life jacket, will drive." And here they come, just about side by side. K-class, 1,200 horsepower machine. Dive back into the corner another time. Give it to Wood by a boat length.
By a boat length, and he has the inside track, the smoothest way, the quickest way around this race course.
428 cubic inch engines they begin with, and they just add anything they wanted to make them go. Look at that wide line taken by Nordley.
He's keeping his speed up on the wide line, but he's losing some distance in the turns, Ken.
And in the background, that was Jay Ellington coming back in the picture. He can kiss his national title hopes goodbye if he stays in third place.
Butch Jensen's boat from Las Vegas, Nevada. He owns a welding shop there. His driver, Wood, out in front, trying to take this championship. You never use all the horsepower you have in these boats, do you?
You never can. George told me he uses about half throttle at the most.
Here he is, back one more time, George Wood. He's raced in every class, races every weekend, probably 25, 30 races a year. Coming down, checkered flag, ready to fall. And the K Division Championship goes to the state of Washington and George Wood. Oregon's George Nordley will finish in second. California's Jay Ellington comes home in third. In a moment, you'll meet the master of the super modifieds, George Wood.
Alley and standing by with a winner, here's Bob Varsha.
We're with George Woods, the pride of Sumner, Washington. George, you made this step up to the flat bottoms and you got a national championship to show for it. How's it feel?
Oh, boy. It's fantastic, Bob. You know, the owner of the boat, he's been fantastic. This is the first time we've driven a boat. And earlier this week, you know, we had some handling problems. And the owner's just been working with the crew nonstop for 5 days. And today, we hit it. It was right on. It was a great ride, and we had some left to use if we needed it.
You've got experience in both the hydros and the flat bottoms. How do you compare them?
The ultimate rush is a K racing runabout. It turns on a dime, and there's always half throttle left. If you want to use it, it's all up to you.
How are the water conditions out there? The wind's been a problem all day.
Yeah, it's a little rough, but the runabouts, you can plate it down a little bit and run over the top of it. You know, it's we're trying to keep the speed, you know, down a little bit slower than normal. We're probably running maybe maximum 130, 135.
Well, congratulations. A hard-earned victory.
Have
a good time.
Thank you very much, Bob.
We're pleased to report that after all this incredible, furious action in Dayton, Ohio, everybody out of the hospital and all right. Let's review some of the moments of the 1985 Inboard Championships.
If you're lost at sea,
And so we have crowned the 1985 U.S. Inboard Powerboat Champions after a weekend of spectacular action here in Dayton, Ohio. For Jim Cropfield, Bob Varsha, Jerry Garrett, Sandra Ray, I'm Ken Squire.
Promotional consideration and fee paid by Mercury Marine, producers of Mercury outboards, Mariner outboards, Mercruiser stern drives and inboards, and Quicksilver marine parts and accessories. This program has been brought to you in part by America's fastest growing beer, Coors Light, the Silver Bullet. There's no slowing down with the Silver Bullet.
Welcome to Ypsilanti, Michigan on 4.